So we start where we left last time, Jimmy enjoying the Southern Ocean and on a hot day. This is part two of shoulder dystocia, and here is where we discuss a number of more advanced internal maneuvers and the possible complications we most likely would want to avoid. From cloudy to clear. In part two, we will discuss the management by using a number of internal maneuvers when the external maneuvers, as we discussed in part one, have not resulted in the delivery of the shoulders and the baby. And we will present a number of complications. Well, if the external maneuvers haven't resulted in a good outcome, delivery of the baby, it's important to stay calm, there's no despair, and we apply to a number of more advanced or internal maneuvers. This is very much a matter of hands-on, or maybe we should say actually hands-in. You insert the fingers and the hands inside the maternal pelvis, but also know what to do yourself and keep communicating to the mother and the team members around you. These skills are essential. I cannot underpin that enough. The skills, they should be practiced. It's not enough when you read a book. You can practice some of the skills on a mannequin as an individual, but most importantly, we have now a number of courses. The ULSA course, the MOET course, and the PROMPT course. And they all help us to practice obstetric emergencies as a team. Enter the E of of the helper mnemonic. We have now a number of internal maneuvers. In fact, we have four internal maneuvers. And the first maneuver is the Rubin 2. What does it mean? We insert the index and the middle fingers. In this example, in the diagram, the baby's back is towards the maternal left, so it's an LOT position. So I would insert here my right index and middle finger. You insert it in the sacral space posteriorly. Then you move your fingers upward alongside the baby's back until you reach the scapula. And you put your fingers behind the scapula and you put pressure behind the scapula to rotate the anterior shoulder away. So that would be a contraclock movement in this diagram to move the shoulder away from the bony pubic bone. By the way, there is limited space here, and that's the disadvantage of maybe this maneuver. But again, whatever you do, if you do it on a regular basis, you will be good at it. You develop and enhance your skills. So here you see a beautiful diagram from the book Obstetrische Interventies, where you can see the baby's back is towards the maternal left. The shoulder is stuck here above the pubic bone, and with the right hand of the accoucheur, the pressure is to move the shoulders away, the anterior shoulder away from the pubic bone. One, there is more room in the oblique diameter, away from the AP diameter, and two, we will make adduct the shoulder. So when the baby is ROT, you would use your right hand. And when the baby would LOT, you would use your left hand. So essential to know the position of the baby. And of course, in modern obstetrics, most of us would have done an ultrasound scan to confirm this. So we're not taking a gamble here. We know where the baby's back is. Essential to do. Then there's another maneuver. The second maneuver is the so-called wood screw maneuver, if the first maneuver didn't work. We insert now this left hand in this example, and here we position the left index and middle fingers anterior of the posterior shoulder. That means at the level of the clavicle. So the right hand is still in the same position at the baby's back, behind the scapula, and the left hand is in front of the clavicle. And now both fingers, both hands work, they create a momentum, and both work, rotate counterclockwise in the example. And again, we use no extra force momentum of two additional fingers to rotate the shoulders away from the pubic bone. So the principles are clear. Here we can see the diagram again from obstetrische interventies. You can see the right hand is behind the scapula and the left hand is in front of the baby, and you can see both the vectors actually to alleviate the shoulder dystocia. There's also an option to do a reverse wood screw, and that means our left, we can remove our right hand now and we move our left hand who was in front of the shoulder now, we move the left hand behind the baby's posterior shoulder and we try to rotate again in now clockwise direction. So the first maneuvers were counterclockwise and now we try to do clockwise. Again, we want the posterior shoulder to rotate into the oblique. And we want to diminish the distance between the two shoulders. Then in the helper mnemonic, I found that somewhat confusing. Now we go back to a relatively simple maneuver, which could be done by everybody, because that means rotating the mother onto all fours. That means the mother should adopt the hand-knee position. Of course, that's not possible if she has a dense epidural block. It is also quite challenging if you're dealing with an obese lady. And now, an important, the primary shoulder we want to deliver is now the posterior shoulder by gentle downwards pressure, and we can use the existing room in the so-called sacral space. This is, I think, essential for every birth attendant to know. Even if you would do a home delivery, this can solve the problem without the risk of major complications. Beautiful diagrams, I love it. We can see here what happens if you rotate the mother on all fours. Basically now we can enter the sacral space and we have a lot of room. By the way, this is the situation I want to refer to. This is what you do if the woman turns on all fours. These pictures are illustration of another maneuver I will discuss later. I'm happy to show you right now. Here, the accoucheur is trying to deliver the posterior shoulder, and you see what happens. You go enter, you enter, and you make sure your hand stays in front of the baby's abdomen. And here is, you say almost, you shake hands to the baby, you take the baby gently by the wrist, and you externalize, you bring the posterior arm downward and outwards. Okay, so the removal of the posterior arm, which already showed in the previous diagram, you insert the hand into the vagina and the sacral space across the fetal chest to identify the fetal elbow. The fetal arm is flexed and swept around the fetal chest and maternal perineum. And that means by doing that, we deliver the posterior shoulder as well, and we move away from the anterior posterior diameter where the shoulders were stuck. For some obstetricians, this is the most favorable internal maneuver because they argue there is more space in the sacral area and they find it very easy. And if you deliver the posterior arm, yeah, that in principle solves the problem of the shoulder dystocia. Again, everybody might have his own favorite approaches, that's fine, but as a team, I would recommend that we stick to a certain sequence of events, otherwise it's confusing for the team around you, if every doctor sings his own tune, so to speak. Here we see the removal of the posterior arm, removal between quotation marks. You can see the hand, the arm has been swept across the chest of the baby, like it's wiping the face of the baby with the hand, and the posterior shoulder has come down from the sacral promontory, and that's why we create space. So here is important that the left hand, in this example, needs to be on the ventral side of the fetus to bring down the hand, the arms, and the shoulder. Okay, the helper mnemonic. I have already showed that I'm a little bit critical. Not to be pedantic, but the episiotomy, you know, you don't need an episiotomy if you turn the lady on all fours, or you do flex the hips, or you exert suprapubic pressure only when you start entering. So with the three internal maneuvers, or the fourth internal maneuver, which is removal of the posterior arm, then one can consider an episiotomy. So, as you know, I am fond of the KISS principle. Let's keep it simple. Always ask for help. That's non-negotiable. Everybody would agree. And this is important because when we're inside the consulting room, there's a very individualistic approach. You can call the shots as an individual and you advise your patient whatever you think is most appropriate. But here it's teamwork. The external maneuvers should be bread and butter stuff for anybody working in labor ward or doing deliveries at home. So flexing the hips, encourage the mother to push, and gentle downward pressure on the fetal head. Traction, actually, I should say. Sideways suprapubic pressure is the second maneuver. And you stand in principle at the side of the fetal back. Make sure the bed is not too high. Make sure you can do this comfortably for half a minute or a minute, either intermittently or continuously. And then the third maneuver is to rotate the mother on all fours. Combine these with gentle traction of the fetal head, apart from the third one. Then the internal maneuvers are really good, important, essential for GP obstetricians and obstetricians to master. First, we have options behind the symphysis pubis anteriorly. So we push the anterior shoulders away from the symphysis pubis with the index and middle fingers of one hand, behind the baby shoulders, or we use the other hand's index and middle finger in front of the baby shoulders to create momentum with both hands, or we use the index and middle finger on both hands. Then posteriorly, we can use the existing sacral space to release the posterior arm and to swipe that across the fetal chest. At this stage, it has no use for the mother to push. To the contrary, she should try to breathe calmly. Then we have a number of last resort, I would like to call them third line maneuvers. Zaffanelli, that means if all the maneuvers have failed and the baby is not yet born, simply push the baby back up and back in, push the baby's head back in, ask the mother to stop pushing. You might give a drug to discontinue the uterine contractions, and you do an urgent crash cesarean section under general anesthetic. Zaffanelli has published a few cases with a favorable outcome. No randomized clinical trial, obviously, just a case series. Another method is a cleidotomy. That means you fracture the baby's clavicle with a finger by pressing. And with that pressure, by the way, you'd reduce the diameter of both between the shoulders. In case of we are dealing with fetal demise, we actually can cut the clavicle with scissors to have the same effect. That could be the case in the fetal demise of a macrosomic baby. Symphysiotomy. That's a method used quite easily and deliberately in the developing world. To us in the Western world, in the well-to-do countries, in the so-called rich countries, I should say, it's not used. It seems to be cruel, but it's not. People who are in the tropics, in the first world countries, third world countries, tell me it's quite easy to do. They have a special large scalpel. And by cutting the connection between the both pubic bones, make sure, by the way, that an indwelling catheter is inserted so you avoid the urethra, and immediately you widen the pelvic inlet and the shoulder dystocia is resolved in that way. People who are familiar with this method tell me we should do it in the developed world as well, but we don't. It's amazing how women, for instance in Africa, after this procedure, they leave the hospital in a few hours, go back to their village, and it seems to heal remarkably well. But again, this is a method where I'm not familiar with, so I have never applied it myself. So this is the diagram of the syndesmotomy. You see an indwelling catheter to identify the urethra, and here you have the special knife. I think personally this is a little bit unsafe when you put your fingers there, because if you cut too far, you might index and middle finger might be damaged, and that's not a good idea. So documentation, important for counseling reasons, future management, and for legal reasons. So make sure that you have documented all these times, the time of the delivery of the head, the time of the diagnosis shoulder dystocia, the direction of where the head was facing, so OT or ROT or LOT, then what maneuvers were performed in what sequence and the timing thereof, and then eventually the time of the delivery of the baby. Then when staff, so as for instance anesthetist or the pediatrician arrived, and of course the EPCA score. And most importantly, always do a paired umbilical artery pH and vein. That's important to demonstrate whether the baby might have had hypoxia due to the shoulder dystocia. So complications, this is a part of the profession we all find dreadful. I can tell you every complication is very unpleasant, first and foremost for the patient, the woman and her family, but also for you as a doctor. Because perfectionist as we are, complications, you don't want to have complications, but it's part of your profession. So for the fetus, plexus brachialis injury or the so-called Erb's palsy can occur in 4 to 16% because of stretching of the C5 to C6 upper root. And usually it's transient and only 10% remains. And sometimes even nowadays we can offer neurosurgical restoration of if the roots have been severed. By the way, the child has a typical posture of the arm and the shoulder, and it's like the police officer requesting a tip. It's one of the things you fear as an obstetrician. I can remember one case where I had an irreversible Erb's palsy after a very difficult to manage shoulder dystocia. A nail in the obstetrician's coffin, I can tell you. Fractures of the clavicle and humerus, especially when you deliver the posterior arm, that's, by the way, is for us not a big deal. They heal well without permanent injury. But for the mother, it's very sad and confrontational that her newborn baby already has a fractured clavicle or a humerus. But explain this and understand that for her it's very stressful, and don't underestimate that. Then fetal hypoxia. On average, as soon as you call the shoulder dystocia, every minute the pH falls by 0.04. So that's not dramatic until the baby is breathing appropriately. So you have 10 minutes, but you don't want to postpone it more than necessary. In severe cases where we were unable to deliver the baby or do eventually the crash cesarean section, it might result in fetal demise. The tragedy of a fetal demise. For the mother, postpartum hemorrhage is increased risk, and there are two videos about that. You can click on the links here. And of course, a fourth degree obstetric anal tear could be the case. So important if the baby is born that we thoroughly inspect the perineum and do the pill roll test to verify any damage to the external internal anal sphincter. The brachial plexus consists of the cervical nerves 5 through 8 and the thoracic nerve 1. And this plexus, the upper part of the plexus, provides the nerve supply to the entire arm and shoulder and is essential to hand function. So, because we hate complications, you know, after, if the baby is born, there's no hypoxia, the baby is breathing well, we feel already, great, let's move on, because, you know, you get a phone call from the emergency department and you have to do other jobs. You might be very busy, but it's very important. Keep in close contact with the mother and the family. That is part of our job and part of our duty. It's part of being a caring doctor. Show that you care as long as is required. It doesn't matter that you feel good about the outcome. It's what the mother and the family feels. Listen in those encounters. Listen. Try to understand what is going through her and their mind. That's far more important than explaining and waffling. By the way, lawyers sometimes advise us not to speak to the family anymore. I couldn't disagree more. Speaking as a human being is not equal to admitting guilt or being at fault or having made the mistake. Some lawyers warn us not to be in contact with the family, and you have, by the way, the opposite of the effect you want. You want the parents to understand what happened, that you did your best, that you followed best practice guidelines. But what happens if we come across as arrogant pricks? The doctors delivered the baby, have never seen him anymore. If we come as arrogant pricks, we are at risk for litigation. And I think that is rightly so. So the take-home message of Soulless Social: be prepared always, with or without risk factors. Follow as a team a certain sequence. External, there are three maneuvers: flexion of the hip, suprapubic pressure sideways, and turning on all fours. And internal, we have discussed four maneuvers which should alleviate the shoulder dystocia. Essential that you know how to manage it as a team. Because if I am delivering the posterior arm, well, at the same time, one of the midwives could do the suprapubic pressure sideways if we work in the same way. So team effort is essential. This concludes part two of the series of shoulder dystocia. From cloudy to clear, I hope. And as you can see, my glasses are clear and Jimmy makes eye contact with the cameras and we are all happy. By the way, important. Thank you for paying attention. And again, Jimmy, my Zen master, tells me always be in the now. It's good to work and to work hard, but very important that you have downtime, laying in the shade, or as the Italian says beautifully, il dolce far niente. Thank you so much and see you next time.